Good morning, Solomon's Porch. Good morning. Let's rise to our feet. Welcome all of our children to family worship. Woo-hoo. Okay, it's always a privilege. Yeah, if you're here with your children, we just want to invite you to come to the front. Come to the front with your child so that they can see you worshiping the Lord and they can learn from you. Everyone, especially our children, just a reminder, we're not here to play with our friends. We're here to meet with God and to worship Him. So let's give God our attention at this time. Okay? Parents, if there are any toys or anything like that, even if it's not your child, you can just grab the toy from them gently and give it to the parent. Amen. Okay. All right, let's recite the Apostles' Creed together as a confession of our faith. You can look at the screen and you can follow along with us. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, from which He shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this time. Thank you for bringing us here. We want to give you our hearts in this time. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would come and be with us, speak to us, touch our hearts, God, and help all of our children to sing to you and to encounter you and to learn about you today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, today we have a very special opportunity for my family to do probably our last time leading motions for family worship. So let's invite my family. Woohoo! Thank you. Okay, go to your places, please. Okay, Owen, thank you. All right, let's focus. Okay, this song is for our little ones. So Owls class, I know you guys learned this song in Owls class. So let's sing this together and let's worship God together. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do for you. My God is so big. The mountains are His, the valleys are His, the stars are His, and He works too. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do for you. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do. Are His handiwork. knew this song we learned last time. It's from YWAM, that we learned it from Campfire. It's the Lord's Prayer, so let's sing this together. Our Father in heaven, whoa, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. His love came down, down, down. My prayers go up, up, up. God gives me what I need. God gives me what I need. He gives me what I need. Sing verse 2. Give us this day. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debt as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. His love came down, down, down. My prayers go up, up, up. God gives me what I need. He gives me what His love came down. His love came down, down, down. My prayers go up, up, up. God gives me what I need. He gives me what I need. Yours is the kingdom. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. For yours is the kingdom. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. My prayers go up, up, up. God gives me what I need. He gives me what I need. His love came down, down, down. My prayers go up, up, up. God gives me what I need. He gives me what His love came down. Your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show. Song. Let's thank the Lord with this song. I like to think about the goodness of the Lord. He gives me everything I need and so much more. So I just want to lift my hands and say that I love Him. I just want to lift my heart in praise. I want to be thankful. I want to be grateful. I want to remember everything that the Lord has done. I want to be thankful. I want to be grateful. I want to be. I like to think about the goodness of the Lord. He gives me everything I need and so much more. So I just want to live Him. I just want to lift my heart in praise. I want to be thankful. I want to be grateful. I want to remember everything that the Lord has done. I want to be thankful. I want to be grateful. I want to be. So I just want to lift my hands. So I just want to lift my hands. And say that I love Him. I just want to lift my heart. Yeah, I just want to lift my hands. So I just want to lift my hands. And say that I love Him. I just want to lift my heart in praise. I want to be thankful. I want to be grateful. I want to remember everything that the Lord has done. I want to be thankful. I want to be grateful. I want to be. Yay. All right, let's give a clap for our dancers. Thank you. We're just going to sing one last song, but SP Kids, this is not a kids song, but so I want you guys to think about the words, okay? I think for most of you, you're old enough to think about the words we're going to sing about. the cross of Jesus Christ and the price that he paid for our sins to be forgiven. Okay, so let's learn this together and let's continue to focus on the Lord.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my riches gain
to see from his end. Give to the Lord our all, our heart, our this time.
Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. Bids me come and die and find that I may truly.
Sing that line one more time, but let's open our hands like we're surrendering our all, our life, our heart, our all. Let's give to the Lord. Oh, the wonderful cross.
Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross.
come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. All who gather here by grace draw near and bless your name.
Father, we, oh, there you are, sorry. Father, we just come before you at this time, this privilege that we have to just continue to meditate on the power of your sacrifice, Lord. Father God, won't you help us all, from the youngest to the oldest, Father God, really, Lord, cause our hearts and our attention, our affections turn to you. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for you are the giver of life, our physical life, Father God, but ultimately and most importantly, Lord Father God, our spiritual life found in you. And in Matthew says, for whoever would save his life will lose it. That's when you think just about how you would take care of your life. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. And so we just want to declare, Lord Father God, the reason why you came in the first place was so to give us life. True life. Help us to continue to meditate on the power of your sacrifice, and most importantly, the victory and the way that you have given us opportunity to live life victorious and overcoming in the power of the Lord Jesus' name. Father God, all that you give us, you have just provided fully, generously. So help us, Lord, to walk out today with that incredible encouragement and conviction. Thank you, Lord, for your God. You are all in all. We give you all the praise and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Sorry, I forgot. Okay, so at this time, we're going to just take a few moments to say quietly as we can, goodbye to your parents, and go off to your classes, except for the Spark and the Rockets. We'll give them a moment. All right, quiet kids. You can do it quietly. As we have all of our kids exit, please to pray, excuse me, please to pray for them that they would really be able to get what God is saying and doing in their lives today. Yeah, we just thank you, Lord, for all of the teachers, Father God, parent helpers, Lord Father, that are here to serve the families and deposit into the next generation. We just want to bless them as they exit, and just praying, Father God, just a real deposit of whatever it is that you are doing in each of them to cause them to be able to grow in you, Father God. All right. All right. Thank you. Say hello to your friends in the classes, guys. Let's in this room. Parents, too. Chit-chat later. Yeah. Thank you, guys. Remember, Spark and Rockets don't leave yet. If you are, then just give them some space. All right, little ones. You'll see your parents in a few moments. You can let them go. Have fun in class. All right, everyone. Thank you. Let's exit quickly. Spark and Rockets, you wait just for a moment. The usual. Okay, all right, slowly. Yes, thank you, everybody. Yeah, so in the meanwhile, I just want to welcome everyone in person and online. My name is Lisa. I'm in charge of the children's ministry here called SP Kids. If you have anyone that is interested in having their kids come, you have friends that want to come, or just are interested to be able to visit, do let us know by looking on the website, and you can find a form that you can fill out for that. Yes, thank you. All right. I think parents need more reminders than kids too. Okay. So with that, also, we want to welcome those that are here for the first time or newer to our church. On a count of three, we'd love to just give you a small memento of your visit here and to be able to connect with you. So on a count of three, could I please get hands risen to show us where we can pass this gift to you? So on a count of three, one, two, three. Anyone here for the first time? Yes, wonderful. Welcome. All right, fantastic. Welcome today to church. All right, wonderful. So in this little gift, in this little gift, we just have a couple things that could remind you of us, and also a connection card. You can fill out if you're interested to find out a bit more about us. For those online, you can look as well on our website, and there's a QR code, and you can go ahead and also fill that out. We'd love to get to know you and be able to introduce you to our community here. Also, if you fill out today in person, you can also take it back to the coffee bar area and enjoy a free coffee on us and some refreshments. And of course, that's for everyone else to enjoy as well. All right. So if you are newer, we also want to be able to help you to know that you can get connected through our smaller groups called house churches. And that's really the lifeline of our church, where we're able to get together with smaller groups. Groups to be able to walk together, learn about God, and be able to walk together in faith. So you can look online, as well as there is a QR code as well for those that are online or in person. So please do check that out. The ones that you see on the website are still available to be visited. So do contact the leaders for that. All right, and with that, we're just going to take a little bit of time to say hello to our neighbor. And this is when the spark and rockets can be excused. Thank you, guys. All right.
Hello, good morning. Welcome to church. My name is Angela. I have a few announcements to share with you all today. So firstly, we have Sports Day, which is our sports event on Sunday the 5th of May from 3 to 7 p.m. at CAIS International School. So please do join us for a fun-filled afternoon of volleyball and dodgeball, where you have the opportunity to showcase your skills, foster fellowship, and enjoy friendly competitions. All ages and skill levels are welcome, so sign up via the SP website, or you can scan the QR code up on the screen. Next, we have our summer mission trip, and this summer we'll be partnering with FCA, which is Fellowship of Christian Athletes, to serve in a football/soccer camp in Japan. And the dates will be from the 17th to the 24th of August, and it's gonna be in Tokyo and Nagano. And this will be our first mission trip with FCA, so we will form a small team this year who will serve alongside the FCA missionaries and having fellowship with them and the local church, praying and enjoying sports together. So our primary focus will be to bless and learn from those who faithfully serve in Japan, and this week is the final week for sign-up, so please do sign up before the deadline, which is the 21st of April. And if you want to find out more, please sign up, or you can go to our website, or you can sign up via the QR code on the screen, or you can talk to Tim after the service. We also have a young adults hangout day on Saturday the 20th of April, and this event is for those who are under 35, and it's going to be filled with a delicious barbecue, a hangout room with board games, and lots more fun and games involved, and it will be in Kwantung from 4 to 9 p.m. So please do sign up if you are under 35, and you have to pay a fee of $350, and a deadline is in 2 days, which is April 16th. So that is all the announcement, and now it's offering time. Please prepare your hearts to give to the Lord. And if you are visiting us, please don't feel any obligation to give, but you are more than welcome to. And we have Matthew from Happy East House Church. He'll be praying for us, and the worship team will share a song.
Let us prepare our hearts and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day where we can gather here in your sanctuary to worship you. Thank you for your continuous loving us. We love because you first loved us. Thank you for your never-failing promises. Lord, I pray for our offerings, Lord. Let us give freely and cheerfully as you have instructed. I pray for a generous heart in us to give and to have compassion in those in need around us. Let the fund be used according to your will and deliver in the right hands. Let your wisdom be in us in using the funds. Father, I pray for open heart and ears to hear your words today. I pray for your Holy Spirit to dwell among us and touch us. Let your words sink in our hearts and continue to grow deep inside us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And now let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we also forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and glory.
Let your kingdom come, Father, let your will be done, on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come, Father, let your will be done, on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us as we forgive the ones who've sinned against us. Forgive them and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come, sing, it's yours, it's yours, it's yours, all yours, all yours, the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours. It's yours, it's yours, all yours, all yours. The kingdom, the power, the glory are yours. It's yours, it's yours, all yours, all yours. Forever and ever, the King, Father, let your kingdom. Let your kingdom come, Father, let your will be done, on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart.
you so much, worship team. Good morning, everyone. Lovely to see you all. My name is Chris, and I'll be delivering the word today. So we'll start with a word of prayer. Lord, thank you so much for your incredible love, your goodness. We thank you for the grace of God, the sacrifice, resurrection of Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit that is with us, that is available to all of us, Lord God. And today, Lord, we pray that you would do what you will in our midst, a mighty work in our hearts, in our spirits, and then may you awaken, Lord God, the faith in us, that we may enjoy you even more, abide in you, and do your will here on earth as we seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. I humble myself before you, Lord, and ask that you would preach your heart, your word through me here this morning. And I pray that you'd give receptive hearts to hear what the Spirit is saying to each one of us, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, as you know, the theme for this year is Come Holy Spirit. And today, I'm going to walk us through a bit of a case study of someone in the Old Testament who is filled with the Holy Spirit. That's David. P. Sam also kicked us off last week about revival. And so when each of us are moving in the direction that I'll go through in a little bit here, then I believe we as a community, we will experience God-ordained revival. Now I'm going to go through a specific chapter in the life of David. And it might be a chapter that we're not very familiar with, because it's kind of like, it could seem from a distance, like you go down a road and then it ends up being a roundabout, a no-through road, and then you just come back out. That's what it could kind of seem like. But and when you delve into it, there's actually a lot of significance in there. So today, I'm going to go through a number of verses, verse by verse, in this chapter. And I'm going to talk about living faith versus hospice faith. Now, if you don't know what hospice is, I'll go through that as well. I was explaining to our three children this morning what hospice is, and I went through some of the analogies that I'll be giving in today's sermon as well. And then my second point is going to be that our faith, life of faith, is not a linear one, right? So if you remember back to elementary school mathematics, linear, right? Linear. Linear, right? Kind of straight line. Our faith, our life, is not a linear one. It's non-linear. So if you look at the life of David, it's completely non-linear. It's kind of all over the place. And the third one is a call to each one of us, depending on where you are, to draw near to the Lord and receive what he has for you. Now, so we're going to go through a particular chapter in the life of David. And so we're very familiar with the life of David. And so I'm going to put it first in context. Okay? So David is a young shepherd boy, right? A nondescript youngest child, house of Jesse, tending to the sheep. God speaks to prophet Samuel and says, I want you to go and anoint the next king of Israel. And so we know the story. They line up all the sons, skips every one of them, and God says, I look at the heart. I look at the heart, not outward appearance. And so is there any other son? So they bring along David, and he is anointed. Young boy, right, anointed the future king of Israel. So that happens. And then he goes out. We go to the one of his most famous scenes when he takes on Goliath, who's still a young man. He takes on Goliath, defeats him. Hero of Israel. Goes out to more battles. Hero of Israel. He wins all the battles. His fame goes up. His popularity goes up. Saul gets anxious, fearful, jealous, and determines, I'm going to kill David. And so David runs away. He's on the run. Now he's on the run, running away from Saul and the army. And at some point in 1 Samuel chapter 22, a group of men come and join David. And this group of men end up becoming the core of the mighty David's army. Okay, so the first verses we'll come to is 1 Samuel 22, verse 1 and 2. So we'll get that on the screen. He's going to read this for us. So David departed from there and escaped to the cave of Adullam. And when his brothers and all of his father's household heard of it, they went down there to him. So verse 2, this next verse, describes the profile of David's army. See how amazing they are, right? Everyone who was in distress, and everyone who was in debt, and everyone who was discontented gathered to him. And he became captain over them. Now there were about 400 men with them. So this is David's mighty army. He's got 400 men who are in distress, in debt, and discontent. Now, one could think, if the army is a group of spiritual men, right? Here are the priests, the people who, you know, serve before the Lord. Okay, great. We heard in the Old Testament, God's army went out, sang a song, and then boom, there would have been battles. But there's no indication that these folks were spiritual leaders in any way, right? In fact, they probably committed some crimes and had to run away. There's no indication here necessarily, although you could surmise, that these are physically strong people, right? If you think about people who are in distress, people who are in debt, not necessarily strong men. The ones who are discontented, maybe, but if any of you have been, and I'm sure many of you are, in leadership positions, that's not a great profile of team members to be a captain over. You really need to dig down deep to your leadership skills to be able to lead a group of men like that when you're on the run, right? So David is now on the run, running away from Saul with these 400 ragtag band of misfits. That's David, right? This army, not even army, this group of 400, just want to get make sure it's in our head. This is not like Gideon's 300, right? Went from 10,000 to 300. It is not the 300 Spartans in the movie 300, like well-built men with their, you know, sword and spear. They can take on an entire army. This is a bunch of misfits. There's no indication they had any military training or experience at all. Now we come to the chapter in the text that I want us to go through. So it's first, it's the next chapter, 1 Samuel chapter 23, verses 1 to 14. And I'm going to take it one verse at a time. I'm not going to read it front to back. I'm going to take it one verse at a time. So verse number 1. Then they told David, saying, "Behold, the Philistines are fighting against Keilah." Keilah is a city in Judah. "And are plundering the threshing floors." Now, there's a situation that comes before David. One of the cities or villages, whatever, of Israel is under attack by the enemy, the Philistines, right? They're subject to injustice. What is David, the anointed future king of Israel, going to do? There's no indication that David had any particular affinity or connection to Keilah, right? He wasn't from Keilah, right? It wasn't like his wife was from Keilah. It was another city in Israel. David, as I was going through a little bit before in context, wasn't in a great position. He is with this ragtag group of men running for his life when this situation is presented to him. So what are the choices? Thank you very much for letting me know about the situation in Keilah. I gotta get going. Bye-bye. Or here's a more spiritual approach. Okay, men, let's get together, hold our hands, say a word of prayer for our brothers and sisters in Keilah who are under oppression. Saul will hopefully, you know, come to his right mind and go rescue them. We're going to pray for them, for their salvation and rescue, and we're going to move on. Or he could have been very knee-jerk reaction. All right, they messed with my people. I'm going to go in and take them on, right? A lot of different choices that David could have made. Which choice did he ultimately make? Let's go to the next verse, verse 2. So David inquired of the Lord. David asked God, shall I go and attack the Philistines? That's all he asked. Shall I go and attack the Philistines? Shall I go? And the Lord said to David, go and attack the Philistines and deliver Keilah. Now, there's a lot we can see in what David asked and what he didn't ask God, right? So he asked God, shall I go, me, the guy who's running away from Saul, I've been rejected, I have this, looking behind me, a bunch of grumpy old men, shall I go and attack Keilah? Attack the Philistines and deliver Keilah, right? Shall I go? He could have said different types of prayers. He could have said the self-preservation prayers, right? Okay, God, you know I'm on the run. You know I'm the future king of Israel. Future king of Israel can't get hurt right now. Which way do I go so I avoid the Philistines, right? Seems like a lot of trouble here. What's the detour that I need to take so I don't get hurt, right? He doesn't pray that prayer. He doesn't pray, God, shall I go? And by the way, am I going to die? Fair question. You go to battle, you go to war, you got to expect some people are going to die. Right? This isn't, shall we go and minister to the homeless? Shall we go, right, give out cookies to some people? This is putting your life at stake and saying, shall I go and fight them, right? He doesn't ask, am I going to survive? Maybe some of the men will die, but me, am I going to survive? He doesn't ask that either. He doesn't do the token prayer. God, bless them, help them. All right, let's move on. Nor does he pray the calculative prayer. All right, God, here's the situation. I see your heart. You said I'm a man after your own heart. I see that you're not happy with this oppression that the people of Keilah are facing. I'll help them out as long as you help them out, but I want some quid pro quo here, right? We deliver, I do your will, and there's going to be something in it for me too. He doesn't do that. All he asks is, shall I go and attack the Philistines and deliver Keilah? And God says, yes, basically, go do it. Do it. Then what happens? Next verse, verse 3. But David's men said to him, behold, we are afraid here in Judah. How much more then if we go to Keilah against the ranks of the Philistines? Right? So he turns around to the men and says, all right, men, we're going and we're going to attack Philistine. The Lord has said so. And the men say, time out, David. That's crazy. Right? That's great. By the way, these men haven't even fought a single time yet. Right? Just came together. They're saying, that's an army. David, we are running away from another army, and you want us to go and attack this mighty Philistine army. That's ridiculous. And logically speaking, that makes all the sense. Like, David, are you out of your mind? Why are you attacking the Philistines? So there's opposition, and probably David, being a smart guy, heard it and thought, you know, that kind of makes sense. Maybe I was being a little impulsive, you know, I was still living out my glory days against Goliath. Maybe I need to take a step back and think about this again. So what does David do? Verse 4. Then David inquired of the Lord once more. Bless his heart. Right? He didn't say, hey guys, all right, I heard from God, we're going to go forward. He could have done that. Maybe he should have. But maybe there was something that kind of like, yeah, I don't know, you know. And so he goes back to God. He doesn't change his mind. He doesn't bury the word of God. He goes back to the Lord. And the Lord answered him and said, arise, go down to Keilah, for I will give the Philistines into your hand. Now, God says, I will deliver. I will give the Philistines into your hands. God is going to fight this battle for him. So what happens? Verse 5. So David and his men went to Keilah and fought with the Philistines, and he led away their livestock and struck them with a great slaughter. Thus David delivered the inhabitants of Keilah. What do you know? They win the battle. And this particular battle, there's not a lot of description in here, but it doesn't sound like one of those battles from Old Testament where the choir goes out in the front and sings and, you know, the army collapses and runs away in confusion. It looks like they actually fought. Now, I don't know if it's because these men didn't know any worship songs, right, or what was the case, but they actually fought. And maybe that was important for them to know as an army to get some of that battle experience and actually fight and see God come through. So they had a great, it was a very, very clear victory. Verse 6. Now it came about when Abiathar, the son of Ahimelech, fled to David at Keilah, that he came down with an ephod in his hand. This is a little bit of an aside. In the prior chapter, Saul gets really upset at the priests in the city called Nod because they had hosted David. And so he decides to kill all the priests. One priest escapes and comes to David here, and he ends up becoming the high priest when David becomes king. Verse 7. When it was told Saul that David had come to Keilah, Saul said, God has delivered him into my hand, for he shut himself in by entering a city with double gates and bars. Let's look into that a bit. Look at what Saul says. God has delivered David into my hand. Saul is making a great assumption, an imputation of God's will based on circumstances. Saul still thinks God is with him. God is on his side. And he thinks, wow, David made a terrible tactical error in going and helping out the city Keilah and shutting himself in this fortress. Easy pickings for me and come and attack. Hallelujah, God is with me. God has delivered David into my hand. How interesting is that? He thinks God is on his side, and he assumes God's will based on facts and circumstances. I'm going to pause there for a second. How often do we do that? We look at facts and circumstances and goes, God must will this. God must not will this. And when we think God wills something and it doesn't turn out the way we think it would, we say, oh God, where are you? You didn't do this for me. Now we can see from the text here, oh my gosh, Saul, you're completely off track. But he, in his heart of hearts, believed God was with him and that he knew what God's will was. Let that be a moment of humbling for us, where we assume God's will based on circumstances. And I think if we reflect on our lives, there's probably a lot more times that we do that than we probably would like to admit. And contrast that with what David did. He each time asked God, communicated with the Lord, and submitted his will to the Lord's will. Versus Saul, who there's no indication he was praying at all or having any sort of communing with God, and he looks at facts and circumstances, comes to his own conclusion, and assumes that that is God's will. Verse 9. Now David knew that Saul was plotting evil against him, so he said to Abiathar the priest, bring the ephod here. Verse 10. Then David said, O Lord God of Israel,
Your servant has heard for certain that Saul is seeking to come to Keilah to destroy the city on my account. Verse 11, will the men of Keilah surrender me into his hand? Will Saul come down just as your servant has heard? O Lord God of Israel, I pray, tell your servant. And the Lord said, he will come down. Such an interesting exchange. Now we're kind of conjecturing it here a little bit, but the very first time when David looked at the Philistines, Keilah, he thought, all right, God, shall I go down and take care of some business? Very simple. Maybe he had a bit of swagger left over from his defeat of Goliath. But when he hears that Saul is coming, those words seem like the words of someone who's a bit anxious, maybe even desperate. Right at the end, in verse 11, he says, O Lord God of Israel, I pray, tell your servant. He's pleading, God, please tell me. Right? There's something more going on inside his heart. And God says, and it's very interesting what God says. Now, if you look at the verse, David asks two questions. God only answers one of them, right? David's first question is, will the men of Keilah surrender me to Saul? That's the first question. The second question is, will Saul come down here, right? As I have heard. God only answers the second question. He says, he will come down. That's all he answers. So what does David do in the next verse? Verse 11. Will the men of Keilah surrender me into your hand? He realized, hey, God, you didn't answer the first question here. Will the men of Keilah surrender me and my men into the hand of Saul? And the Lord said, they will surrender you. Interesting, huh? Sometimes we ask God multiple questions. He only answers one of them. You can ask follow-up questions. Now, for now, I'm not going to go into, you know, is there any significance in God only telling the first part and not the second part? We'll leave that for another day. But what's also interesting is all God says is Saul is coming and the men of Keilah will surrender you to him. That's all he says. God doesn't say, therefore, get out of here, buddy, right? Better run. God doesn't say, go attack them. That's all he says, what's going to happen. Now, how does David respond to that? Verse 13. Then David and his men, about 600 now, so I guess he got some recruits from Keilah, arose and departed from Keilah, and they went wherever they could go. When it was told Saul that David had escaped from Keilah, he gave up their pursuit. Verse 14. David stayed in the wilderness in the strongholds and remained in the hill country in the wilderness of Ziph. And Saul sought him every day, but God did not deliver him into his hand. Now before, when David asked, and as amazing as David is, he probably asked the wrong question. He said, will the men of Keilah deliver me into the hand of Saul? Maybe he should have asked, God, will you deliver me into the hand of Saul? And God would have said, no. Good, then what shall I do now? Shall I stay here? Shall I go? What should I do? And we'll see what God might have said. And David, not perfect, didn't ask all the questions that would have liked him to have asked, but when he heard that Saul's coming and the men of Keilah are going to surrender him, he's like, that's it. No more asking God questions. I'm going to make my own judgment. I'm out of here. Survival mode, and he left. He didn't even ask God where I should go. He went wherever he could go, wherever he could go. But God was still faithful to him. And in the last verse, it says, but God did not deliver David into the hand of Saul. Okay. So you can take the verses off now. I'm going to talk about living faith and hospice. It's a little hard to pronounce that word. Hospice faith. Living faith. And an example, not a perfect one, and an example of that is David. Let's look at his heart. His heart seeks after the Lord. The Lord saw his heart. David was known as a man after God's own heart. And so that even when he was in distress, even when he is running away, he could see a situation and feel the heart of God for that situation, that he would ask at the risk of his own life, shall I go and take care of that injustice? Having a living faith, actually seeking the kingdom of God and his righteousness above all else. Close relationship with God, having the kind of communication that David had, that kind of intimacy that David had with God. And of course, that's only possible by the grace of God, love of Jesus Christ, and the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. Now let's put a pin in the living faith, and then let's talk about hospice faith. I didn't really read this anywhere. I kind of came up with it, so it's not a great analogy. So please take this analogy with a big, huge grain of salt. So hospice, what is hospice? An example might be there's a 95-year-old woman who has just been diagnosed with cancer, and if you leave it be, she'll probably die within 2 years, or she could have a very invasive surgery, which may cause complications. She might die right away. Or if it goes really well, she'll live in a lot of pain with radiotherapy and whatnot, hair falling out and body shrinking, but you could live 5 more years. So 2 years versus 5 years, you're 95. You might choose to go to what's called a hospice care center or hospice care at home. Basically, okay, we're not going to do any surgery. The goal here is not that you're healed, that you recover. We know you're going to die, but let's just give you some comfort. Let us help you die comfortably, right? That's hospice care. And that distinction is important from a hospital, the ER, the ICU, where you're trying to actively cure, right? Rectify a situation. What does it look like then for our faith life to be like hospice-like, right? So let's say you personify your faith as a human being and you check into a hospice care center. You can kind of imagine what people do or don't do at the hospice care centers. It's probably spending a lot of time lying down. If you're able, then you take a little short walk in the day. You get your, you know, things checked out all over. You watch some TV. If you're fit enough, play a few games. You go to bed day after day after day. Your conditioning's worsening, right? If that's our faith life, that's not a living faith. It's more like a dying, a long, prolonged death kind of faith. Now, what are some of the examples or litmus tests of whether we might have inadvertently or consciously ended up with hospice faith? If we find ourselves sharing, you know, my spiritual life really isn't all that good, I'm in a bad place, and maybe one day I'll do something about it. Maybe one day I'll do something about it. Or if we find ourselves passively waiting for an undeniable sign from God of what his will is, right? Then, I guess I'll do something. An undeniable sign from God. If I see a sign, I hear the audible voice of God that I should go to fill in the name of the country, then I guess I'll go, right? Now let's analogize that to children. We've all been children, we've been around children, we may have children. Now this doesn't happen in my household, but maybe it happens in yours. But if the eldest or one of the elder comes and says, oh father, mother, I see that my beloved younger brother and sister are having a hard time with their homework. Shall I go? Like David, right, said, shall I go? Shall I go and help them? And then I'll think, immediately, she wants something from me. Okay. What do you want, right? You know it's free, right? You know I'm not paying you for this. I don't think I've ever heard that or anything close to that. What we see here much more in our household is, go do this, and like, why, right? Can you please help your brother do that? No, why? I don't want to. I shouldn't, right? Where's the heart? The heart, if my kids, me and my wife sitting on the second row here, if our kids understood our heart was a girl or a boy after the heart of their mother or father, they would say, oh, father, mother, shall I do my homework now? Shall I go and help my younger brother? Shall I do this? Shall I do that? We're like, yes. And they don't have to do the quid pro quo thing. Will we not pour out upon our children? Oh my gosh, they understand the heart of the parents. But if it's always like, go do this, go make a bed, go do this, go brush your teeth, you know? They're not boy and girl after the heart of their mother, father. And if our faith is like our children, all right, God, I'll do it if you tell me, okay, fine, right? I mean, really? I mean, you do have those Jonah stories, but based on, I think, history and based on my life experience, when God sees a heart that's like, don't come near, don't say that word, he probably won't, He's looking around to see if the hearts of men and women understand his heart and approach him and say, God, shall I do this? Shall I do that? What's another sign that we might be living, walking in hospice faith? We find ourselves, our prayer life is like, yeah, right? Nominal prayer. Lord, help me today. Go. At the end of the day, help me sleep well. Good. God, I'm sick. Heal me. Not a lot of prayer, but we're so good at analyzing and hypothesizing about the will of God. Some circumstances happen. We apply our intellect against our experience, and we say, God's will is this, God's will is that, right? If we find ourselves, our prayer life is not so good, but we find ourselves often assuming, hypothesizing about the will of God and being so confident in it, that might be a sign that our faith is stuck in a hospice. I'm going to give an analogy of a runner. A guy called Harvey Lewis, who's one of my new heroes, not because of his faith, but because of his kind of dedication to exercise. So Harvey Lewis is a 47-year-old high school teacher, and he recently won, and I told my house church this, he recently won this race called the Biggs Backyard Ultra Marathon. I think it's held in Tennessee once a year. And the idea is really incredible and almost very harmful, I think. But someone came up with a bright idea. Let's do a race till the end where there's only one person remaining. And so there's a track that's 6.7 kilometers. It's in the sort of bush, right? There's sort of like trees and you can trip over roots and other things, right? 6.7 kilometer trail that you run. And the goal is, the rule is, you have to run it within 60 minutes, right? You have to run within 60 minutes. If you do any lap and you miss the 60-minute mark, you're out. You're done, right? You're out of the race. And they do this lap after lap after lap until only one person remains. Can you imagine that race? So this guy, Harvey, won late last year. They're going to have the event again this fall, I guess. So Harvey won, and he's a high school teacher who was apparently a bit chubby as a kid and really wanted to one day run the Boston Marathon. And for those of you who, I don't, but run marathons, I heard, nobody can just sign up for the Boston Marathon. You have to run a certain time to even be able to run the marathon. He tried for 12 years to try to qualify for the Boston Marathon. And he finally qualified to run the marathon. Now, he doesn't win the marathons. They say marathon, right? Physical, mental. You got to be a certain physical build to be able to win marathons. Ultra marathon, then I think the ratio of mental to physical goes much heavier on the mental side, right? So he wins this race, and he ran that track, that 6.7 kilometer track, 108 times. It took him 4.5 days. 4.5 days. So you kind of wonder, he eats as he runs, right? He said he ate mac and cheese, he ate like, you know, different vegetables and juices. If you finish the first lap within 60 minutes, you take a nap for like 1 or 2 minutes, you get back up and go. Now imagine when you wake up from a short sleep, like your sleep's been interrupted, you get up, are you ready to run 6.7 kilometers, right? Can you imagine you've been running, 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 you take a 1 minute nap, you get up, you gotta run another 6.7 kilometers. He ran 108 times, so that is 724 kilometers. And for those of you who are familiar with the geography of South Korea, that's running from Seoul, which is almost on the border of North Korea, to Busan, which is the southernmost city of Korea, and then back. Running from Seoul to Busan, and then back, without stopping, without sleeping, and eating, and taking care of other duties as you go along. That was Harvey, did that. Pretty incredible. And I guess apparently the 107th lap or the 108th lap, those two guys left. Can you imagine, you know, the two guys running along? But what if Harvey, he's 47 now, as a 40-year-old man, right? As a 40-year-old man, says to his family, he's got the same build, physique, potential, everything. He doesn't have any cancer, let's say, right? It's same exact same condition as the Harvey, the winner of Big Back's Barnyard, whatever race, and Harvey, you know, who's gonna do this other thing. When he's 40 years old, he comes to his family and says, guys, I'm gonna check into a hospice center. How would you react to that, right? Like, Harvey, are you out of your mind? It's like, yeah, you know, I've been teaching high school a lot. The kids kind of get at me. I think I'm done. I heard about this really great hospice center where you sit, they give you food. I can lie down, watch TV all day, play some bridge. I'll be the fittest person there. I'll probably win every athletic competition in the hospice center. I'll be a champion, right? That's what I'll do. And you're like, God, no, no, Harvey, that's such a waste of life, waste of potential. This morning when I was kind of going through a little bit of my sermon with my kids, I said, kids, so they don't know a lot of NBA, but they know a little bit. So I said, what if when LeBron James was 15 years old, came to us and said, guys, I lost this high school basketball game and people booed me and I got injured. I'm gonna check into a hospice center now for the rest of my life. And the kids look shocked, they're like, no, no, you know, that's crazy. Yes, why would LeBron James as a 15-year-old young boy at that age, with his physical giftings, check in to a hospice center for the rest of his life? Rest of his life. Sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? I'll tell you what else is ridiculous. Given how incredibly big God is, how incredibly faithful he is, given the incredible work of Jesus on the cross, given the incredible power of the Holy Spirit as shown throughout the scriptures, throughout the world, for us to check ourselves, our faith, into a hospice center, ever, ever, and certainly not now. How crazy is that, right? How crazy is that? We could be like Harvey in our faith life. We could be like a LeBron in our faith life equivalent in the basketball arena. But we've checked ourselves knowingly and unknowingly into a hospice center. And when I was praying this morning at service, as we were doing the worship, I had an image, I visualized many people actually, not everyone, but many people in our community walking into our church on wheelchairs, on hospital beds with like IV dripping thing, like people being carted in. More than a few of us coming from our respective hospice centers. Physically, we're fine, right? Sunday best, or maybe not the best, but you know, whatever, neat enough. We come, we look physically fine. And yet, if we look at our spiritual condition, I wonder if there are, if I am, coming in a wheelchair every Sunday, being carted in on life support, on a bed. But here's the cool thing. That image, when we came in, we prayed, we worshiped, people get out of the wheelchair. People get out of the bed. They start worshiping. The faith is awakened, right? Yay, hallelujah. And hence, when we go to retreats, you expand this 1.5 session over 2 or 3 days. Wow, we're out of our wheelchairs. We're out of our hospice beds for 3 days. We feel alive. You see potential. Your faith grows. And then retreats, maybe the tail end takes a little longer. But the moment we go out, especially when Monday morning hits, we look for our wheelchair. We go lie down again on our hospice bed in our faith. The question is, how on earth, in light of how amazing God is, how incredibly faithful he's been throughout history and throughout our lives, the incredible work of Jesus Christ on the cross and who the Holy Spirit is, how can we possibly end up in hospice care in our faith? Now, again, distinguished from hospital care, we could end up there, right? Go through some trauma. We need to go through time of healing, right? But hospice is saying, all right, I'm going to have minimal faith, barely on life support for the next 4 decades, right? How do we end up there? How do we end up there? Now, you can blame others, blame situations, but I would like us to look at ourselves first, because we could so easily, inadvertently, end up in those places, partially or wholly, short-term, medium-term, or long-term. So, in preparing for the sermon, I researched a little bit about hospice care. You know, thankfully, I haven't had to really research it in real life for any of our family members. But so I took a look, and I took a look at Wikipedia. And if you go to Wikipedia, there's a section that says, here is the goal of hospice care. And I thought it was very telling. It says, the goal of hospice care is to prioritize 3 things: comfort, quality of life, and individual choices. Hospice care is to prioritize comfort, quality of life, and individual choices. Now, that makes sense in the physical realm. But if we, as our life priority, are knowingly or unknowingly prioritizing comfort, quality of life, individual choices, and not, as the Lord says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, we can easily end up in hospice care in our faith. Let me try to sing that song. Seek ye first comfort and quality of life, and pursue your individual wishes. And on Sunday morning, if it doesn't conflict with your schedule, log on to sbhh.org and listen to this sermon. It's very uninspiring to sing the chorus to this with that. Now, I say that jokingly, but when I read that, my gosh, was I convicted myself. Was I convicted myself? That's what the world says. You look at any ad, right? It's about comfort, quality of life, individual choices. Make your own decision. You're your own God. You make your own assumptions about what God's will is. Never inquire of the Lord. I know what God's will is. It's not that, it's not that, it's not that. It's this. Me pursuing what I'm doing right now, because we like to justify and feel good about our current choices. And hence, this is God's will. Because he hasn't told me otherwise, I haven't seen a sign from heaven saying I must do something else. Let me ask, when's the last time each of us asked the Lord the question, Lord, shall I? Shall I? I talked about my kids. Shall I help my siblings with the homework? Shall I help you with the dishes? Shall I, God, do this or that? When's the last time we pray that prayer? And what happened when we pray that prayer? I'll give you some examples. I'm going to make some assumptions, so if I mention your name and you say, ah, Chris, that wasn't quite it, do let me know. But I'm going to assume the better thing. There are a number of us here, and I'm not going to single out any particular ministry. These are just examples. We have wonderful ministries in our church, but I happen to know Brother Lawrence, and Sister Sissy, who volunteer at Recreation and Recreation, helping with the drug addicts who are recovering, right? I think they each ask, shall I go and serve? And they go and serve. And it's inconvenient, yes. Sissy was going even when she was pregnant. And if you've ever been to where they go, it's not a short cab ride. You gotta go all the way to Sai Kung, then take a bus, and then take a speedboat, and then go on a short hike to get to the center. And she would go. Brother Godwin, Sister Rebecca, they looked at the refugees living in the new territories, asked, God, shall we minister to them? And they have a beautiful Shanti ministry that's been going on for years, changing the lives of so many. Pastor Ernie and Shimmy, they look at the Filipino helper population in Hong Kong and pray, shall we open up a church where they can come and worship? And hence was born Spill. Once Pastor Ernie came to our house church and he shared with us his weekly schedule. Let me just say, that weekly schedule did not sound like comfort, quality of life, or individual choices. It was definitely not comfortable. It sounded painful. Quality of life, I was concerned for his health. And individual choices, he was completely surrendered to the Lord. In case you don't know, he works full-time as well. And if you've been to Spill out in Yuen Long, it is an incredible but full court press ministry that they do. My wife, Amy, she's a stay-home mother. All three of our kids used to go to Korean International School, and we lived in Sai Wan Ho, and now we live in Taikoo, and there's a lot of Korean community there. And so you naturally become close with the mothers. So the mothers naturally become quite close as they talk about kids' school and classwork and other things. And she saw that a lot of them are not believers. And so she decided, God, and I was praying with her, shall I start a Bible study with them? Shall I run an alpha course with them? And she did both. And she's been doing that for years now. And the fruit of those ministries have been incredible. Let's look at the wonderful people who are serving in SP Kids. I'm sure they all prayed at one point, Lord, shall I go and serve? And I'm not singling out any particular person. I'm just, a straw man situation where someone might come and be a member of church for years and always be complaining about SP Kids, like, oh gosh, they don't do this right, they don't do that right. I wish they were more like this in this church, in this country. They do this. Why can't we do that? Yet they don't do anything to actually help SP Kids. And I'm going to single out one of the volunteers, Nicola, who's going to give birth at the end of this month. She has three kids of her own who are three boys, so quite a handful. She is, 8, 9 months pregnant? and she's still serving on Sunday with SP Kids. Not comfortable, not good for quality of life, but surrender to the will of God. Our faith life journey is not linear. This is my second point, and I'll just briefly describe this. Maybe we did step out in faith. Maybe we said, Lord, shall I? And you went. And then things didn't turn out the way that you thought they would. Or maybe they did, but it wasn't a linear progression. Glory to glory, victory to victory. You went through the valley of the shadow of death for a while. Well, let's look at David. He risked his life. He heard the audible voice of God, rescued the people of Keilah. The people of Keilah were going to totally throw him under the bus, betray him, surrender him, and so David had to flee. That's why at the outset of the sermon I said, this is a little bit of a nondescript, almost a footnote chapter, because you kind of go down this road and then you kind of back out and you go out again, and like, what happened there, right? He was on the run, he risked his life for these people, and then he's back on the run again, right? And the people that he rescued, or well, God rescued through David, ungrateful, totally willing to betray him. Now David could have checked in to a hospice care center, woe is me for the rest of my life, at that point in time. But he kept going. He kept going and taking one step after another forward. And yes, he continued to experience ups and downs. He eventually did become the king of Israel, one of the greatest reigns in Israeli history. My call to action for all of us is, if that's you, where at some points in your life you did answer the call of God, or you did initiate and you felt like you fell flat on your face, and you feel like you're in an even worse situation than when you started, don't lose heart. Get out of that hospice care center. That's not where our faith belongs. Let's get back in the game. There's so much more to come that God can and will do through you. So as I wrap up, and I'd like to invite the worship team to come up, I want to speak to two groups of people. The first is, when you hear what I'm saying, you're like, ah, gosh, maybe I'm in a... when he first mentioned hospice care, it's like, ah, that's definitely not me, but maybe... maybe I'm in hospice care, or maybe not quite hospice care, but semi-retirement village. There was a time when I prayed some bold prayers. Lord, I will do whatever you want me to do. And then other things kicked in. Comfort, quality of life. Yes, not quality just for you, but for your family, parents, kids, individual choices, and we're not really there at this point. The second category, group of folks, are folks who were once, you know, on the front lines, and man, God's call upon my life, you had a powerful encounter with God, and prayed the bold prayers, and went out, and you know, shall I go? And I went, and God came through. Shall I go, Lord? I went, God came through. God called me, I answered, I went, right? And now it's, I'm not so bold in my prayers anymore. Been there, done that. I'm kind of semi-retired now. And, you know, the next step is the hospice care. And I'm not quite there yet. You know, I still am active at church. But I wish I could be, you know, hospice care one day, and I like my semi-retired life of faith. If that's you, I feel like the Lord wants to touch us, reignite our faith, call us out of that hospice care center, call us out of the retirement village where our faith might be residing right now. And say, no, get up. Get up, oh mighty warrior. I am with you. So if you could all stand together, and as the worship team leads us in the song, and I guess because of children's worship, we have a lot of real estate in the front. Feel free to come to the front as well. Kneel before the Lord and let the Lord minister. And as people come, we'll pray for them as well.
Jesus, I am yours.
will give to you my everything. All I am and all I have to bring, I will give to you my everything. All I am and all I have to bring.
My prayer is that we would not look for our wheelchairs, that we would not look for our hospital beds when we leave this place. That on Monday morning, as you get dressed for what's to come that day, that you don't tuck away your faith in hospice care center to have a heartbeat until house church time or on Sunday morning. And then you come out of your wheelchair again on Sunday morning to dance before the Lord again, and then go back into that wheelchair. And when we as a community stand and run together, when we abide in the love of Jesus Christ together, we will experience revival. So Lord Jesus, we thank you that you called us not to just survive barely in our faith. God, your grace is too big for that. Your power, your love is too big for that. Help us, all of us, to tap in, Lord, to more of you, to seek you above all else, and experience the life-giving outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon our lives. And the Psalms would come out from that. Close us with the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, shalom, from this day forth and forevermore. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Bless you guys. If you need prayer, please come down to the front. There'll be people ready to pray with you. Amen. God bless.